I'm the co-president of the MIT Water Club, and I'm also a fifth-year PhD candidate in the MIT Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution Joint Program in Oceanography. I study harmful algal blooms, and specifically how a changing climate is affecting their timing and intensity. So as we heard in yesterday's interpret panel, climate change is poised to affect many different aspects of the Earth's water resources, which can have a multitude of downstream effects that are difficult to anticipate. As a native Californian, one relevant example of this for me that was recently in the news is the recent closure of the California Dungeness crab fishery, which is worth over $60 million a year. Officials measured lethal levels of the toxin domoic acid, which is produced by the harmful algal bloom species known as Pseudonychia. This massive toxic algal bloom is thought to be fueled by the exceedingly warm water temperatures produced by this year's El Nino, which is already one of the strongest on record. So like so many other water challenges, there are many stakeholders at the table. You have consumers, you have fishermen that are now losing their livelihoods, natural resource managers, the ecosystem, the list goes on and on. And that's why we're here today. So I'd like to give a big thanks to our key sponsor of the summit, JWAFS, and also to PepsiCo, Gradient, MIT Civil and Environmental Engineering, Arcadis, DesaloTech, MIT Brazil, MIT MIST Israel, WRI Brazil, MIT DUSP, and the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. Today we've got two really great panels for you. And the first will explore innovation and technology, research and policy. And the second will focus on how, with new tools and an improved information, we can navigate the organizational and geopolitical systems to build a more resilient world. But first, it's my great pleasure to introduce to you John Fernandez, who's MIT class of 1985. He's a professor of building technology in the Department of Architecture and the director of the new Environmental Solutions Initiative. So the Environmental Solutions Initiative is a core part of MIT's new Climate Action Plan. It aims to provide research support for an improved understanding of climate change and practical solutions to mitigate and adapt to it. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome John to the podium.
Good morning. So it's a new initiative in the sense that I'm the new director, but it's about a little more than a year old, Environmental Solutions Initiative. I'm very, very honored and really quite fortunate to be taking the helm of the ESI after Susan Solomon, the interim director, really got it going and got the research agenda anchored. In the topics just mentioned. So I have a presentation. I have about 10 minutes. I want to be straight to the point. It's a bimodal presentation in the sense that the first part is about my work. I thought it would be useful to tell you about myself and how my work essentially brought me to the Environmental Solutions Initiative, and then talk about the beginnings of a new phase for the ESI. As mentioned, I've been a professor here at MIT now for 16 years. The research that I do is in urban metabolism, which simply put is the summation of the physical processes that serve the urban economy. So it's the resources, the physical things that make all of this possible. All the human activities within a city. Curiously enough, urban metabolism, that phrase, was launched in a Scientific American article by Abe Wolman. And I don't know how many of you know who that is. He's a pioneer of sanitary engineering at Johns Hopkins University, really spearheaded modern municipal water systems in the United States and elsewhere. And he wrote an article, a thought experiment, about what are the resources required to run cities. And it's a Scientific American article of 1965, and it really launched this idea that we really should know what resources are required so that we can understand how we can be more efficient, how can we channel and shape that basket of resources. So let me talk a little bit about consequential environmental solutions. So the reason I crafted this title was it's important to consider the consequential actions that we can take related to the environment. In my own work, consequential begins with understanding trends. So Okay, consequential trends, there we go. Population expansion globally, you know all about it, but in terms of urban population, the developed north is quite urbanized, the developing south. So Africa, Asia still has quite a long way to go. It seems as if, well, you might know that around 2008, the world population became more urban than rural. It seems like that's a kind of the tendency, the trend, and that will continue to about 65% or so, so in about 2030. So kind of a sobering fact that some of you might know is that in the next 30 years, we're going to double the urban population. And about 90% of that population growth is going to happen in cities in developing regions of the world. And then the largest cities are going to increase. So we, back in 1990, there were approximately 7 megacities, cities of 10 million or more, and today there are 28. And so one of the studies that's been done by a colleague of mine, Chris Kennedy at Toronto, tries to understand the increase in resource consumption related to urban population growth. So if you take the megacity population is 6.7% of the global population, and all things being equal, if a person unit consumed the same as the last person that was added to the urban population, then all of these would be 6.7. But so this is not surprising because cities are centers of innovation and invention and economic intensity. GDP is super linear to population growth in megacities. Waste as well. So if you're in a city, you're generally going to be wealthier, consume more, produce more waste. There's more packaging. Gasoline, curiously enough, is also above the proportion of the urban population, as well as electricity. But overall energy use is on the fence. And this comes from very rough data. So this may be more or less than the proportion of the urban population globally. But right now, we can't say. So we can't really say that it's more energy efficient. You are more energy efficient if you live in a city than if you don't. And the last piece here, it's very clear that urban water consumption is quite a bit less than the proportion of that population living in cities. That mostly has to do with agriculture. So agricultural uses of water outside of the city. So the main point here in my own work is to understand those kinds of resource requirements, to understand that that's going to be happening, the urban population growth is going to be happening, not quite in all like this in the future, but a lot of this. And that urban systems, urban infrastructure systems, centralized and traditional urban infrastructure systems need to be reconsidered. The design and engineering and the whole approach. So one of the things that we've been doing a lot of is mapping resource flows in different places around the world. I'm just highlighting water in Egypt and in Cairo. We have very good data because we have a very good partner in Cairo. And we've been able to map, but then also produce the flow diagrams, Sankey diagrams. So at the country level, the aquifers and obviously the Nile and desalination plant, and then being able to translate that into actual flows for which consumption is also noted, and then to be able to do that at the city level and then begin to project where water consumption hotspots, and taking into consideration that a great deal of unrefined water is going to informal settlement consumption, and then a great deal of the wastewater goes straight back into the Nile. So that's a very, very quick, I've taken 6 minutes and 40 seconds to do that. That's a very, very quick snapshot of the work that I do that has really led me to be thinking about resources globally and to begin to bring that into the Environmental Solutions Initiative. So consequential solutions in the environment here at MIT has been a very long conversation. What is the form of this initiative? What should it be doing? And that's going to continue for the next few months. The executive director, Amanda Graham, and I are it sounds pretentious, but we're kind of on a listening tour. But that's really what we're doing. We're visiting many groups, individuals, departments. And I think what I can say is that, at this point, is that it's very, very clear that there is extraordinarily deep, committed support that the coupling of science, technology, engineering, design, policy with socioeconomic expertise is a form of consequential solution that is required for any progress in doing better for the environment. So after this long conversation, and as I mentioned before, the interim director, Susan Solomon, setting up the seed grants for the ESI to be on very solid research footing, we're now speculating and beginning to formulate, and within a few weeks, solidifying the next phase. And these are just some thoughts that come from an interview recently. For me, essentially, no question that the research needs to go much further, and Maria Zuber, Susan Solomon, and others will say that the physics of climate models need to improve to be able to tell us more specifically in particular locations, what are the ramifications of climate change. But in addition to that, we really need to propose pathways. This is really about moving forward with regard to every aspect of society and across the disciplines, as I just listed. And then the third part that I'm very, very excited about, and actually I can say with some pride that in the last 3 weeks, probably met with 60 different individuals in 8 different organizations. Half of those are students, and half of them are student organizations. So I've met with the undergraduate dorm presidents, DormCon, in the basement of Massey, to talk about what do they want to do with the environment. So and one of the reasons I mentioned that particular meeting was because maybe one of the most important things we can do with the Environmental Solutions Initiative is the most important thing that we do as academics, and that is to mentor and to teach and to learn from, and then to launch students to be ambassadors in the greater world for doing good in the environment. So consequential, but that's those statements, these nice sort of, you know, sound bites are really not enough. This is where we are going to begin to really articulate specific areas for which MIT has expertise, and we're now really thinking about what are the really quite strong, formal, robust partnerships that we can make with organizations, people, agencies outside of MIT. Some of that has happened, but we're going to really accelerate that. And so the concerns for the Environmental Solutions Initiative, so one of the questions that is asked often is, how are we different from MITEI? Well, this is one way of getting at it. What are the concerns that the Environmental Solutions Initiative really wants to focus on? So climate change and the consequences, that's needless to say. But as Alexis said before, it's not just that. Biogeochemical cycle changes, water is right in there, right? But nutrients, phosphorus, other elements, important elements in the environment. Diversification, proliferation of the environmental agents, including pollution. So no question that pollution, urban pollution, pollution generally, the proliferation of inorganic but also biological agents that are prompted by climate change and other environmental dynamics is part of what we will be looking at. And actually, there are several groups here at MIT that really do extraordinary work in that area. Ecological disruptions and fundamental transformations and collapse. And so this is something CEE has some expertise in this and other groups. But this is really just not enough. It's got to be coupled with an understanding and a focus on large-scale demographic shifts, large-scale economic shifts. Talked about the demographic, the the thought leaders here at MIT and who those are. I'm not, you know, everyone's a thought leader, essentially. That's the extraordinary thing about MIT. But some people at the corporate level and corporation level and others are saying that, you know, if I were, if they were planning their careers in their 20s and thought, well, where would I go in the world? Well, the center of gravity of GDP is in Asia now. It used to be in North America. It used to be North America and Asia. It's in Asia now. So we're looking at super large, really fundamental large economic shifts. And then surprise to many is that as opposed to the kind of expectation that many political scientists have, the world has become more complex. And I have to say, bittersweet morning after last night's events in Paris, that the world is growing more complex in governance and stewardship. And this has got to be part of the way we think about large-scale initiatives like the environmental solutions. And so as we think about how one might get to solutions, we're really not just talking about that breakthrough technology or that geoengineering thing or any kind of design that is going to be the silver bullet, just like with climate change. And it's a whole series of wedges and strategies, but it's coupled to the socioeconomic, political. So in the science and engineering, I've already said that the climate scientists will tell you straight up that the climate models need to have better physics, and that's absolutely necessary research to do. We also need to understand biogeochemical cycle modeling. There need to be better models for that. But then also to begin to speculate on what are the material substitutions and also what are the technologies like desalination and others to derive increased efficiency or derive the materials, the amenities we need in a more environmentally benign way. Also just understanding the sources and dispersals of environmental agents and the effects and on biological systems and protecting biological systems, not just human but otherwise. And then better predictive modeling for better stewardship of biological natural capital. On the socioeconomic side, this is not my field, an integrated policy formulation and implementation addressing those demographic shifts. And then understanding the human nature interface. And I've put the human nature interface down here under socioeconomic, but clearly this is a bridge topic that connects these two. I've put it here because modulating that human nature interface so much involves political and socioeconomic decision making. And then as I said at the beginning, really maybe the best solution or one of the most important solutions that we can all work on, and I feel really deeply privileged but also a huge responsibility to be a primary mover towards educating engaged, technically excellent leaders who are excellent here, but also very, very well read here. So that's essentially the story of the ESI at the moment. Again, I want to emphasize that I'm taking over for an excellent foundation from Susan Solomon. I'm very, very excited about the prospects. I'm very honored to have had the kinds of congratulations and also but the best wishes of the community. But that's really not enough. I'm really looking forward to working with all of you. So you'll see there's a lot more to come in the following weeks and months. So thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Divya Panchanathan, and I am a PhD candidate in the Department of Mechanical Engineering at MIT. I welcome all of you to the MIT Water Summit's Innovate panel. Can we have all the panelists in their seats? In the Intrepid panel yesterday, we had an interesting discussion about how data collection, dissemination, and interpretation could help us in understanding water challenges related to climate change. We also understood that innovation in technology, research, and policy are some of the most important ways in which we can combat these challenges. And so today we have gathered together a fantastic set of speakers for our Innovate panel with experience in industrial water treatment, entrepreneurship, environmental protection, and public policy. The aim of this panel is to discuss the role of technology, research, and policy in building climate-resilient water systems. With that, I would like to introduce today's first speaker, Mr. Marcus Quigley. Mr. Quigley is the founder and CEO of OptiRTC, a leading provider of software as a service products for intelligent real-time monitoring and control of water and civil infrastructure. With more than 20 years of experience in the field of stormwater research and consulting, Mr. Quigley has co-authored a number of national guidance manuals for evaluating and designing stormwater best management practices for various governmental agencies. With that, it is my great pleasure to welcome Mr. Quigley on the podium, and welcome to the Water Summit, Mr. Quigley.
Thank you. So, so I'm the CEO of a company actually based in Boston, Opti. We're over by the Public Garden, and we have kind of an interesting story. I know some of you, some of the questions that we have coming up to are geared toward what's happening, particularly around startups, and we're kind of an interesting case in that we spun out of a consulting company with outside capital to form a new technology-focused software firm. And I'll really be giving you a little bit of background in this presentation so you know where we're coming at things. With the very big picture, though, we think we're at a kind of a unique place, and from our perspective, one that we're quite optimistic about. And one of my colleagues referred to this kind of coming period, and I think we've seen it over the last couple of days, where the opportunities may lie, as the great optimization. And maybe that's one of the reasons we picked the name for our company. I'm not quite sure. But it sounded about right. It's particularly in the U.S., which is where we're focused primarily with our work, but I think it applies more broadly as well around the world. We have the opportunity with some new technologies to be able to integrate information into infrastructure. So we really view that the disconnect between information and our ability to act on that information, both as people but also that our infrastructure reacts and reacts proactively to information is really something that we're able to do in ways that we've never been able to do really in the history of mankind. And it's not that this has happened kind of over a long period of time, it's just dramatically transformed in the last couple of years. Most of the things we're doing now, you couldn't do 3 or 4 years ago. And I think it's a rare point in time, particularly relative to civil engineering, that we're in. So hopefully you guys will see things from our perspective after seeing a little bit of what we do. So just to talk about our company, we blend information. So most importantly, forecast information from weather into infrastructure. So we take information. We spent this vast quantity of money on a really effective forecast system in the United States, but also around the world. And we have this information that we typically just use as people to make decisions around. And we have built systems that allow that forecast information to be built into systems that can be fundamentally transformed with that forward-looking perspective. So specifically, we're focused as a company right now, although our technologies apply more broadly, on problems where this is an amazing fit. Large but kind of very niche markets, particularly around stormwater runoff. It's one of the pieces of the water cycle that I think we've almost heard very little about today, particularly and yesterday, particularly in urban areas. But there's huge impacts on our ecosystems from urbanization. And we're focused as a company on improving the way cities work by including this information. So what we really do is we take forecast information, Internet of Things-based sensor networks, combine those pieces of information in the cloud, and then without humans in the loop, our algorithms make decisions about how to operate that infrastructure directly. So the results are that we can have dramatic improvements in water quality, flooding can be reduced or prevented, and that water can be made available that would otherwise be wasted in urban environments. So I'm going to give a few examples of this. So we call this broadly, we have a bunch of different terminologies for it. We're testing different things out in the market, too, to see what resonates. But we loosely call this adaptive control, the idea that design decisions are not something that civil engineers fix in time as they have historically in mostly passive systems for in urban environments, but designing systems, and they're pretty simplistic, that can redesign themselves based on what's going to happen in minutes, in hours, in the coming days. But it's really not physically very complex, and actually one of the reasons it probably has not been taken up in earnest in lots of academic settings is a lot of these types of solutions are, they're integrative solutions. You take conventional pieces of infrastructure that aren't fundamentally different in any way. You add conventional types of controls to them. The hardware to connect these things up to cloud-based intelligent solutions are not particularly interesting. Most of those problems have been solved in the last decade. And then on the information technology side, these are essentially the same systems that run e-commerce, most of the web services that you use on a daily basis. But all these things really haven't been brought together. And when you do, we take basically the minimum thing you need for an adaptive controlled stormwater system is a level sensor, an actuator, a way to connect those things up, a cloud-based intelligent system, and then obviously power and connectivity. So what happens when you take a piece of existing stormwater infrastructure and connect it up in this way? We can do really interesting things. So in this example, there's a storm forecast. This is actually a screen capture from one of our systems when it's operating live. There's a storm forecast. This is actually at an elementary school in Maryland. And this was just in September is the example. That information, this is a rainwater harvesting system, but we control, as you'll see, much larger things as well. But this system has quite a bit of water in it. But rain is forecast. What would typically happen is the tank would fill up and overflow because the demand was not such that that tank was empty, which has significant implications. You've got uncontrolled flows, essentially, from the site. But adding the information about what's going to happen with the weather, the system on its own decides to drain itself down based on what's going to happen in advance of the rainfall. So you can see this is actually the valve just opens on its own based on the weather. It drains itself down. Now the tank is empty for when it's going to rain. The rain occurs. You can see the tank filling back up. And then the valve is closed. A really simple logic, but one that actually is not really something that we could, in a cost-effective way, accomplish a few years ago on something this small at this scale. The result is there was no discharge when the rainfall was occurring from this tank, and most of it would have just flowed out. So it's a really great example of how this kind of basic intelligence can fundamentally change the way a system functions. So we've installed these things. We have over 100 around the country. One of our most interesting is at EPA headquarters in Washington, D.C. Just to give you an idea of how much benefit you can get by just taking a simple system, adding intelligence to it, specifically rainfall information in this case, and what the outcome might be. So we took a 6,000-gallon cistern that sits in EPA headquarters, which had already existed. It had been there for almost 10 years. We just added a simple valve, a level sensor, and connected it up to this intelligent platform and made decisions about when that valve opened and closed. And why does this matter? This is in a combined sewer system. So most of Washington, D.C., when it rains, there's too much flow into the combined sewer, and it results in raw sewage discharge into the Anacostia and the Potomac. If you guys don't know this, we have nearly a trillion gallons of raw sewage a year that are mixed with stormwater that discharge into waterways in the United States. I mean, a pretty stunning thing, right? Of course, this is illegal, and these are the drivers for our markets under the Clean Water Act. So just taking this intelligence, building it into the infrastructure on a 6,000-gallon tank, we are able to reduce the flow, the marginal improvement in flow during wet weather by 100,000 gallons over 1 year without rebuilding anything using existing infrastructure. So you can imagine what we can accomplish. This is a facility in Portland, Oregon, when we have 2 million cubic feet of gallons, 6 acre feet of storage, where Opti is making the same decisions literally today. Yesterday it was raining in Portland, to reduce the flows during wet weather, to minimize impacts on streams, improve water quality, and to reduce flooding impacts. So again, it's the same thing, a piece of existing or new infrastructure that we add intelligence into, and then fundamentally change its value in our environments. So the same thing, this disconnection between information and action can be used in other ways. The exact same infrastructure we're deploying in New York City through a program through HUD, a $30 million grant to New York City to look for innovation around storm surge following Sandy. The exact same system that controls the pond at EPA, the cistern at EPA headquarters, the pond in Portland, these other places can be used to incorporate storm surge forecast and weather information to tell people and to take action independent of people around what's going to happen in New York City to prevent flooding, as we saw during Sandy. And then my last slide, I just wanted to show, we actually had some of these systems deployed during Sandy. This one's in North Carolina. And I think it's the only example of a piece of infrastructure without human intervention that took action on its own to minimize its individual impacts during this superstorm. And essentially, the logic I described before, this system, this is actually, I just did a screen capture, and you can see it's an older interface. It was in when Sandy occurred 3 years ago. I won't get into all the details, but this top left graph, you can see the black line dipping down on the 26th of October. So this was actually captured right when the battery was flooding in New York City on the 26th of October, so almost 3 days before Sandy hit landfall in New Jersey. Opti, this intelligence system, was trying to take this tank and do everything it could to prevent wet weather flows, and it was actually quite successful. It's kind of really fun when you can send your algorithms out into the world and they do good things, and this is just a really interesting example of that. And is, frankly, this was one of the most exciting things. This was early in development of our technology, but we are very optimistic that these new solutions offer tools that we just have not had available to connect information and action. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Quigley. Our second speaker today is Dr. Noel Bakhtian. Dr. Bakhtian has led coordination and strategy efforts on energy water nexus activities for the Department of Energy's Office of International Affairs. In this role, she has supported bilateral and multilateral DOE nexus engagements, including the new $50 million U.S.-China Clean Energy Research Center Energy Water Track, and the Memorandum of Understanding between the U.S. and the United Arab Emirates on Energy and Water. She currently serves as the Senior Fellow in the White House Office of Science, Technology, and Policy. Welcome to the Water Summit, Ms. Bakhtian.
Thanks, Divya. Thank you. Hi, everyone. I'm supposed to say at the beginning that I'm not speaking for either the White House or Department of Energy today, so this is just me. Okay, so yes, I'm Noel Bakhtian, and for all the students out there, I just wanted to mention I got my PhD in aerospace engineering in 2012, and so if any of you are interested in learning how you can switch from something like aerospace engineering or something crazy to working on energy and environment for the government, catch me afterwards. Okay. Okay, so I work on the energy water nexus. I know this is a water summit, but I thought it would be valuable to share why this matters to energy people and why what I do matters to water people. So I'm gonna be looking at this through the energy lens today and giving you the energy perspective. And just something to keep in mind that I'm not actually gonna get to until the very end is about 40% of the water that we use every day here in the United States goes towards energy. So just keep that in mind. Water is very important to energy and vice versa. So here's a quasi-definition of the energy-water nexus for you. Basically, the nexus describes the critical interdependency between energy and water. So we know that energy is vital to the provision of water, and water is ubiquitous in energy production. Okay. I love this one. Why do we care about water for energy? So it's kind of hard to read, but basically this top row here is all of the water that we have in the world. And note this is a log scale, and I don't have to explain that because this is MIT. I love it. So yeah, this is all of the water that we have in the world. The blue on the left is the salt water, and the white on the right, that teeny little bar on the white, is actually the fresh water. So if you expand that fresh water out here, what you see is that most of it, this lighter blue, is actually locked up in glaciers, whereas this dark blue here is the stuff that's actually accessible. So groundwater, lake water, river water, or what we call surface water. If you take that accessible water and break it out, by UN Environmental Program definition, that's what we're calling usable water. So basically, the accessible, reliable, and sustainable supply of fresh water is only about 0.0003% of the global water that we have here. So we don't actually have as much water as we think. And now let's tie that into energy. So I accidentally deleted the slide that was all about water consumption. But there's a difference between water consumption and water withdrawal. But water withdrawal is still the energy system using water, and then just putting it back into the stream or the river or whatever, a little bit warmer. But this is showing here on the y-axis water withdrawal, and on the x-axis you have greenhouse gas emissions. Sorry, it's a little hard to see. Basically, where you want to be here is right here at 0, 0, or even better, energy efficiency, right? But this is showing the different types of energy and how much water they actually need to give you energy. So up here we have nuclear, here's coal. There's all sorts of different types. You can use open loop cooling, you can use closed loop cooling, and that changes not only your efficiency, but actually how much water you're using as well. And what I'd like to point out is that wind actually shows up here. We say that wind doesn't use any water, but of course it's still part of the nexus because it doesn't use any water. So we can go forward and say, hey, if you're having water issues but you still want to move to renewable energy, then look at wind power. Solar PV is actually very low on the water use scale as well. And then I just wanted to share this stat. According to the International Energy Agency, 15% of withdrawn fresh water around the world is utilized for the energy sector. And industrial countries, like I said, 40%. And then on the flip side, if you start thinking about energy for water, I think the stat is something like 3% of the US's electricity goes to water. So it's not negligible. OK, so why does this matter? Just to kind of tie it all together, we can say that the energy sector reliability and viability of different projects is actually affected by water, right? And this is just a plot from the World Resources Institute showing the top 20 shale gas plays in the world, which requires a lot of water to get to. And then in the colors, you see reds are the ones with high water stress, yellow is medium water stress, and white is, I don't think they have enough information. Okay, so this is something that scared the bejesus out of me, so I wanted to share it with you all. So this is NASA satellite, the GRACE data that was just publicized, I think, in the Washington Post, New York Times, probably everywhere, a few months ago. They were collecting data for 10 years, and they basically showed that 1/3 of the largest groundwater basins in the world are under distress. So that's not great. That is bad news for us. So this is groundwater. The blue is okay, the yellows to reds are bad. And then here I wanted to show water stress around the world, just to extrapolate out. Again, World Resources Institute, very cool organization for their plots and some of the analysis they do. But basically, the UN estimates that almost a half of the world's population will be living in areas of high stress by 2030. So all of a sudden, you can see why this is of strategic importance. And these are kind of the five ways that I like to categorize why energy water nexus is important to us, kind of from US-centric down to global. So on the US energy security side, obviously a big deal to DOE. I just showed that energy has a huge, very heavy dependence on water. And as you heard in the intro talk today, with climate change, with population change, with economic shifts, we're going to be seeing more and more water constraints. So we have to start thinking about the resilience of the energy sector to water stress. On economic, that's pretty obvious. We can be selling US tech on a global market. But we can also start thinking about things like accelerating the commercialization of our new technologies via international pathways. And I'll probably let these other guys speak a little more to that. And then there's environmental responsibility, water competition between energy, ag, industry, and even just public use. We can start thinking about, well, we want to be deploying more clean energies because of climate change, and greenhouse gas issues, but do some of those require a lot of water? Yes. Can we be dealing with that? Yes. And then also thinking about responsible energy opportunity, energy operations, AKA the impact of water on ecosystems, thinking about seismic impacts, thinking about water quality. A lot of time we're hearing about water quantity and we're not really thinking about water quality. Geopolitical, so National Intelligence Council thinks that by 2030, the food demand will have increased by 35%, the water demand will have increased by 40% around the world, and the energy demand will have increased by 50%. So this can be causing some problems. There was a 2012 intelligence community assessment that said in the next 10 years, it's predicted that water constraints will increase regional tensions and the risk of of conflict, instability, or state failure in key areas, including the Middle East and North Africa. So the way I think about this is we kind of need to be moving towards collective energy and water security, which is obviously very very interdependent. And then finally, I wanted to hit on human development. As you all probably know, 1.3 billion people in the world still lack electricity access, and something like 700 million people in the world still lack access to potable water. And the interdependency, of course, compounds that challenge when we're trying to provide clean water or clean energy. So what is DOE doing about it? First thing I want to note is, for those of you who aren't familiar with all of the agencies, there are quite a few US government agencies that deal with water, but we're really the energy agency. So when we're thinking about the nexus, we kind of see us as a good way to attack this, because we're the energy agency attacking the energy water nexus. We're very much working in conjunction with all of the other water agencies. There are probably like 10, 12 that we work with a lot. So I just wanted to throw that out there. We released a report. It was summer of 2014. It's a very, very good report. If you just Google DOE Energy Water Nexus Report, it'll come up. So we also have something called the Water Energy Tech Team at DOE. Secretary Moniz recognized that this is a very cross-cutting issue. It doesn't just hit one specific office at DOE. It's very cross-cutting. So what I've done is, this is the org chart at DOE, and I've circled all of the different offices that are actually involved in our cross-cutting team. There's over 100 people on this team, and I'm the international affairs person for that. Something else I wanted to notice, for those of you who think about budgets, budgets are one of the ways that government can affect policy, is 95% of the DOE's energy water budget falls here under someone we call S4, who's the Undersecretary for Science and Energy. So a lot of our R&D falls here. This is Office of Electricity, Office of Energy Efficiency and Renewable Energy, Office of Fossil Energy, et cetera, Office of Science. One more thing on how we organize our thinking about the energy water nexus at DOE is, we kind of have four different groups, but they're all kind of interconnected. But one is technology, RDD&D. One is data modeling and analysis. One is policy analysis. And then one is outreach and stakeholder engagement. Okay, and so you already heard about a Sankey diagram earlier today. This is one of my favorite parts of our report. I think it's the first time that an energy and water nexus Sankey has been created. It was created for this report by DOE. So I'm gonna walk you through it. How much time do I have? 1 minute. I'm gonna walk you through it really fast. Okay, so the top part is energy, and it shows the energy flows from left to right. Bottom is water. It shows the water flows from left to right. I hope you can read it. This is fresh surface water. This is saline surface water, fresh groundwater, saline ground. And then you have petroleum, biomass, natural gas, et cetera. And basically, it shows where the nexus is. A lot of it is right here. This is electricity generation. As I said, you need about 40% of the water that we use every day goes to cooling of thermoelectric power plants. Another one is, see this yellow? This is the electricity coming out of your power plants. It's going to the public supply of water, pumping, cleaning, et cetera. It's going to your wastewater treatment plants over here. Another one is agriculture. You can't really see it, but a lot of the pumping of water for agriculture takes up a lot of electricity. Another interesting thing is, a lot of water actually ends up back up here for feeding the biomass feedstocks, for oil, for fracking. But as you're going to hear a little bit later, you actually get some produced water from fossil as well. And so you're going to hear about cleaning that up and reusing it. These are some of the nexus topics. And I really think of the nexus as an umbrella, and there's all of these energy topics under it. Desalination, hydropower is part of it. So lots of cool stuff going on at DOE and elsewhere on the nexus. That's it.
Thank you, Ms. Bhaktia. Next, I would like to introduce Dr. Anurag Bajpai, who obtained his PhD here at MIT, and he's currently the co-founder and CEO of Gradient Corporation. Gradient is a technology-driven water services company, which is working to enable efficient and economical industrial water treatment and water recycling. It is currently focused on the oil and gas, mining, and power sectors. Welcome to the MIT Water Summit, Dr. Bajpai.
This. Yeah, excellent. Thank you, Divya, for that introduction. Thank you, MIT Water Club, for this opportunity. It's an honor and pleasure to be back at MIT where Gradient started, just on the other side of campus in the RK Lab. So if you guys are familiar with that, we started out developing desalination technologies focused on highly saline waters, highly contaminated waters. And I'll just take a few minutes to tell you what we went through and where we are today and give you a background of what we're doing so we can hear the right questions and discussion. So Gradient, just let me see if I can, obviously IT is not our forte. So that doesn't work, but very quickly, I think the important sentences are there anyway. We are a technology-driven company. We develop new technology. We go out and identify problems and opportunities in the water sector, come back to the lab, develop new technologies, and through a combination of technology and strategy, go out and solve those problems. So we started out at MIT, like I said, with our first flagship technology, carrier gas extraction, focused on desalination of high TDS waters. And then we went out to pilot that in the field with oil and gas customers. After we succeeded in our pilot, we turned that into a commercial facility. And very quickly found out, though, that our solution that we brought to the field was very attractive, but it had a niche market. And in order to really be the one-stop shop water services company that we set out to be, we needed to get into other products and technologies. So as an example, this is our first treatment plant that we set up in Midland, Texas, 12,000 barrels a day. So those would think in cubic meters, 2,000 cubic meters a day, small by large desal standards, but about the right size for oil and gas treatment applications. This plant is currently doing 100% liquid recycling, and how we do that is we take dirty water from the oil wells, send it through our system, we desalinate part of it, which goes back to the customer as fresh water. We only pre-treat part of it, which goes back to the customer as what we call clean brine. The customer blends the fresh water and the clean brine to get to a level that is good enough for them, right? So not in all cases you need ultra pure water. The saturated brine, the reject that comes out at the back end, is actually also sold back to our customer as 10-pound brine. So it's a heavy fluid. You use that to cap oil wells when you need them, either to shut them down or to work them over. So whenever you need permanent or temporary stoppage of wells, you use that. So every drop of water that comes in goes out for reuse in one form or the other. The only waste is a solid sludge that goes to a landfill. So we produce three products there. This uses, it's a thermal process and natural gas, field gas, namely being very cheap in the oil field in the US. That's what we burn there. But the system can, in fact, use other forms of heat, whether it's from a fossil source or solar, as well as waste heat. We're now getting into some applications where waste heat becomes usable and available and quite important. So we won a couple of awards on this technology. This was first when we were just getting out of MIT. We won a Technology Idol Award on this, and then a year later, that had turned into a commercial project, and which was the Industrial Water Project of the Year last year, actually. So that gave us some good good publicity and momentum. But then, like I was saying, we realized that water is a very diverse problem. And anywhere you go, not just in the oil industry, but every industrial customer we're talking, everyone needs something slightly different. And that's fine, as we have adapted to that now. So our customers said, okay, guys, this is good, but we don't need fresh water for all our operations. So we'll do this with you, but we'll go do pretreatment with someone else. And we went to them and said, look, why don't you let us do that too? We'll work with you to develop something. And what we came up with is what we call the SCE technology, the selective chemical extraction. Now, that is not new science. It's existing concepts of chemical precipitation, coagulation, flocculation. All the water folks are familiar with that. But putting that in a new engineering design and wrapping it in our control algorithm that ensures that the system runs automatically and handles the variability in the produced water, in the feed water. Many of large water treatment or desalination systems are designed to run at steady state. So you start up the plant and then it reaches steady state and that's where it runs. This system inherently cannot run at steady state because your feed water and the conditions change on you literally every hour. So, for example, in this plant that's just north of Midland, Texas, again, little known places, this is called Tarzan, Texas. About 7,000 people live in this town, but a ton of oil and gas activity. So these guys wanted us to treat the water minimally, oil and gas suspended, oil and grease suspended solids, bacteria, but they were very picky about sulfates because that messes with their chemistry. So we came up with a way to, one, measure sulfates in line continuously, and things like conductivity and things like salinity are very easy to measure continuously, but things like carbonate, sulfates, isn't very easy to measure on a continuous basis. So how we do that is we actually prepare databases based on our own experience and operating history to correlate certain measurable quantities with the certain unmeasurable quantities. And of course, we calibrate that once in a while by taking samples and taking them to the lab. The control algorithm was very important here because you need to adjust your residence times, your chemical dosings, et cetera, because you don't want to be putting in too little because then your water isn't treated. You don't want to be putting in too much because then you're spending too much. So we started up the system late last year, and this is not a thermal technology. This is mostly the consumption is electricity. So we use a gas or diesel generator on site. Again, many of these sites are either off-grid or the grid is unreliable. Very interestingly, though, when we were about to start this plant, the customer, they really liked our technology, our team, but what they did not like is that we had practically zero operational experience by their standards, right? We were less than a year old in terms of our operating history. And so we went out and we said, look, guys, give us a chance. Let us compete with any other company you want to see operate, and we'll do a three-month showdown, and then you decide which one you want to continue. So we actually entered into a real-life industrial-scale showdown. There were three companies, including Gradient, sitting 100 yards from each other and treating water at 12,000 barrels a day. So it was a massive game, if you would, going on there. Nothing got the team motivated like that. But 3 months later, we came out successful. The other two companies left the site. We're still there. And that set us up not just as a company with good technology, but also good service, safety record, customer communication, which are all very important to being an oil field services company. I just threw this picture up there. Our third plant that we just started up in the southeastern corner of New Mexico. Again, a slightly smaller town than Tarzan, Texas, but again, fairly active area even in the current low activity period. That said, gradient technology is our DNA. So while we have become a service company, we're out there building, owning, and operating plants. We want to make sure that we stay ahead of the curve. We become better than ourselves at every step along the way. So we continue to develop technologies. All of our developments are driven by market feedback. So when folks ask us in the field to do something, we come back and do it. We have some folks here, Simon up there, he's working on a new membrane technology for us now, and partially deployable in the oil and gas sector, but more applications in the other industries. And now that with other industries, we started diversifying out of oil and gas for two reasons. One, we've proven ourselves in one industry, so it makes sense to diversify because water is such a large global problem. But also, as you guys know, the oil industry is a massive slowdown right now, so we wanted to make sure that the next time it happens, Gradient isn't subject to this cyclic nature of the energy industry. Here's just an example of a couple other technologies, ion caging and directional solvent extraction, which are also in our patent portfolio, and we continue working on it. So the idea is, again, to become a one-stop shop technology provider. And if you look at it, we started with one application, which was CGE serving high TDS desalination. And then now with all the portfolio we have, we're practically addressing every single issue that our customers have. We just piloted a disinfection technology for treating bacteria for on the fly for frac jobs. So as we do that, the next steps are to obviously continue growing in the oil and gas industry. Now that the industry is in slowdown, being cost competitive is even more important. You know, when we went out 2 years ago and we said, look, we'll be 30% cheaper than the closest competitor, that's great, that's nice, but now that is critical. And then quickly moving as well into mining, namely in Latin America, and in power, both here in the US and in Asia. So that said, the reason I'm here mostly is to present this to the students and folks doing working in the water world, because we're always looking for excellent people, both on the technology and science side, as well as on the business and financial side. So it's a company that's still growing, even despite all the slowdowns in the industry. So if you guys are looking to get out and work in an innovative environment that's actually commercializing things, we should chat. So with that, I will thank you, and I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Bajpai. My background is in oil water separation too, and I'm now really feeling pumped up and optimistic about my own research. So let's see. Okay, so it's my pleasure to introduce our final speaker, Mr. Mark Ellison. As the Regional Director of Sales for IDE Americas, Mr. Ellison is responsible for business development and customer relations in Texas. Prior to IDE Americas, he served as the manager of strategic water initiatives, where he has worked with communities, industries, and local, state, and federal agencies on water-related projects that have strategic impact on Texas economy. With that, I'd like to welcome Mr. Ellison to the Water Summit. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I'm glad to be here. I'm going to give you a little PowerPoint relief, so and rest your eyes a bit as we go forward. It is my pleasure to come and represent IDE today. First, before I get started, if at any time during my presentation you have a hard time understanding my heavy Israeli accent, just let me know and I'll slow down and repeat it. To the point, I'm a native of Texas, so the accent is a little different. Let me tell you first off who IDE is. First off, IDE stands for Israeli Desalination Enterprises. We're a company that's 50 years old, was originally a government-owned company, was later privatized. We're based in Kadima, Israel. We have completed now over 400 desal projects in over 40 countries around the world. I'll go through some of these projects here in just a bit. Let me tell you what we do, what we are, and what we're not. We're a technology company. We're not a construction company. We're not a consulting engineer company. We're a technology company that provides solutions to water problems that customers have. Of course, our sweet spot has been, continues to be, seawater desal. We have built the three largest desal plants, seawater desal plants in Israel. The latest one that's been up and running now 2 years, Sorek, produces 165 million gallons a day of potable water for Israel. 20% of the drinking water for the state of Israel comes from that one plant. Now, what we don't do, as I mentioned, we're not a construction firm. We don't do consulting engineer. We develop technologies that we use in the facilities that we help construct and operate. We also have a core base of technologies that we work with a Gradient or other companies like that on, where we can supply components to other operating companies in the water space. And so we'll talk about that a bit more in just a minute. Tell you a little bit about projects that we've done, and then we'll talk about where we're going. In Israel, as I mentioned, we have built three desal plants there. Israel was not in the business of seawater desal in a large way until 1999. They decided that, very importantly, that they had pushed conservation as far as they could. They were pushing reuse as far as they could. They had done brackish as far as they could. Seawater desal in Israel was the last resort. And I'll volunteer to you in any water markets, seawater desal is the last resort. We tell everybody that first and foremost, conserve, reuse where you can, look at those other alternatives. Seawater desal, even though, and we'll talk about it more, has gotten cheaper, it's still the most expensive water, but the thing that it has over all other sources is the ocean's always there, and it's can be an uninterruptible supply. Other markets in India, we have built the largest desal plant in India at the Reliant refinery there, which is actually expanding also. China, we've built the largest desal plant in China, once again, at a refinery. They're expanding. We stay active in those markets. I don't have to tell you, some of you are from those countries. They're growing middle class, growing demands, and so we see those continuously as large markets. Here, closer to home, we just recently finished the Carlsbad, California desal plant, supplying 54 million gallons a day of potable water to the San Diego Water Authority in Southern California. It's been very interesting with the drought in California. People will come to us and they'll say, man, that desal plant's really going to help California. It's 8% of San Diego County's water. They got a much bigger problem that they're going to have to work on, and there'll be more plants going in there. We have been selected to rebuild, if you will, the Santa Barbara desal plant that was finished in the early 1990s, and then it rained, and so they shut it down. And so we're going back in to rehab that one and get it started again. So there will be other plants needed there, but once again, seawater desal is going to fill a niche. It's not the total solution. What next do we see? There are going to be more seawater desal plants in the U.S. and certainly around the world, and they're going to be more energy efficient, in part because of some of the work that some of you are doing, have done, and will do. Our Our real focus in our R&D these days is how do we decrease the energy footprint. We've got the most efficient plants in the world, and they're getting more so all the time. I met somebody here earlier working on new membrane technology. We buy our membranes from companies. They're getting more efficient. We now have energy recovery systems in all the plants that are being able to take that power as needed and be able to put it back in the process. So in the U.S., of course, California, Texas, and Florida are certainly target markets for seawater desal. But overseas, of course, as populations grow, there's been two presentations here already showing as these mega cities grow, the concentration of people there, the demands are going to be there. So we'll be working in those markets. Other things, brackish desalination is going to be a bigger and bigger market. In the southwest United States, there's large brackish aquifers, brackish water. It varies the salinity in there, but usually it's about half the cost of being able to clean it up. So we think we'll see more here in the U.S. and around the world on that. Industrial water is interesting in that what we are seeing, and I'll talk a little bit more about Texas, but industries, large industrial operations, are getting to the point with water like they were with power. Virtually all very large industrial complexes have backup power. They have redundancy. They cannot afford to shut down. Many of them are getting to that point as it relates to water, because if they buy their water from a public water utility, in most places, if it doesn't rain, if supplies get low, public health and safety come first. Agriculture and industry get their water curtailed first. And as one person affiliated with a soon-to-be-completed LNG export facility that will cost $13 billion, she said, running out of water is not an option. They need an uninterruptible supply, and so what they're looking for is to have as close as they can closed systems for power and water. Also in the oil and gas, upstream oil and gas side, like I said, we're supplying water through desal and whatever to the downstream refining side. We've got technologies we think that the companies like Gradient might be able to use in their process. But here again, we're a technology supplier to entities working in those areas. The same can be said for reuse. Texas, recently there's two communities have gotten into direct potable reuse. That's taking water from the waste stream, taking it right back around, doing advanced treatment for it and put it into the potable stream. Of course, there was a lot of hesitancy at first, but nobody's died, nobody's grown a third ear. It works. Now, we've been in the water reuse business forever. When one community puts it in the river, it flows down the river, and another takes it out. That's going to be a large market. There again, we're in a niche market for that, where we provide technologies to companies who build large wastewater plants. Let me close and tell you a little bit about the market I'm focused on a lot. It's close to home for me in the Texas market. We have 27 million people now in the state of Texas. When we had our last record drought, our drought of record in the 1950s, we had 7 million people. We have 1,200 people a day moving legally to the state of Texas, a few more illegally come, and then natural population growth. Our rivers and our lakes aren't getting any bigger. We're not going to build any more big, huge reservoirs in the state of Texas. The subject came up yesterday, evaporation. Any reservoir you build in the western two-thirds of Texas, half the water is going to evaporate. So we're going to have to look for other sources. We'll be part of that in the seawater desal business. Conservation's got to be part of it, but we're going to be looking to your innovation to be able to help us stretch that. And as a word that the first speaker today used that I like, our stewardship of water has to get more serious, and we have to take it more serious. So you're going to be part of that. And with that, I'll end. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ellison. So we can begin like the panel. So my first question is going to be related directly to the topic of this summit and the topic of this panel. So has climate change led to innovation in the public and private sector to spur new industries and regulatory frameworks?
Now, repeat your question again.
Has climate change led to innovation in the public and private sector to spur new industries and regulatory frameworks?
Well, I guess we can start at my end. I'm going to take a little different angle on this one. I never get asked about climate change. Our water customer is interested in the lowest price and it always being there. I never get asked about climate change. That's a bit unfortunate, but price, price, price is what they want to do. It's what they're looking for. Now, that said, let's keep it among ourselves. There is a way to get to the climate change issue. And it's that the solutions that we're going to provide for getting them that lowest cost water, one way we're going to get them lower cost water is we're going to use less energy. We're going to find ways to use less chemicals and inputs for that. So the new infrastructure that's going in for new consumers, or the infrastructure that'll go in to replace aging infrastructure, will be more efficient when it comes to that use. But the thing that we have to understand is, as companies, you have to respond to the demands of your customer, the people who are going to pay that water bill. And so there's still work to be done to get people to look at the environmental stewardship side of it. But and when it comes to water, it's about price and reliability.
I'll throw something in there. I think, and I don't know what you all heard yesterday, so I don't know if this has come up, but you know, how do you link climate change to the water hydrological cycle? And I'm not an expert on that. But when I think about it, I think about you know, the timing, the form, and the intensity of the precipitation. So for the energy water nexus, we start thinking about hydropower. California's hydropower production has gone down a lot. As far as thinking about innovations in technology, you have to start thinking about more efficient turbines. You can get more power out of the same amount of water. Also need to start thinking about biofuels. You know, where we used to grow them isn't going to be where we're going to be able to grow them in the future. So how do you move those crops? And then another thing to think about is the temperature, obviously. The temperature is changing. That means the temperature of our groundwater is changing. Sorry, of our surface water is changing. And so when we think about all of the water, the 40% of water that goes to cool power plants, if the water is warmer, now you're not going to be able to cool the power plants like you could before. There were issues with this in France. They actually had huge blackouts in France. In the US, we've had to curtail power plants before because of the water temperature being too warm. The other thing to think about is human response. As the temperature gets warmer, we're going to be using more air conditioning, et cetera. That's more energy use again. So it's kind of a positive feedback cycle. So just some thoughts there.
I think the outcomes from climate change are kind of more broad across civil engineering. I think what we should focus on is probably the second part of that word, which mm-hmm. that phrase, which is designed for change. Mm-hmm. The consciousness around the design assumptions, whether you're in an industrial environment or an urban environment, particularly the assumption of stationarity, is one that I think is largely being acknowledged as a poor strategy. Robust designs incorporate uncertain futures. And I think largely we built our cities and even our industrial strategies around certainty in the availability of underlying resources, in the conditions under which those structures and systems have to operate. And if the thing I think we're seeing the most is that regardless of what your opinion is about the direction of or even the cause of the change, we can do better just at a design level. Yeah. And we also think there are lots of tools to do this. Like when we make lots of assumptions about let's say you're building a wastewater treatment plant, about what the use of water is, and they're so ingrained in the design from then on, we just need to address those problems in a completely different way. So I would have you focus on change, design for uncertain futures, regardless if they're political, if they're climatic, if they're regulatory, because that's the world we really live in, and I think that's what we're all coming to realize.
Yeah, I agree. So what Noel said, climate change, maybe not directly, but it has created conditions that have led to innovation. In our view, that innovation that's driven by climate change and the associated things like water scarcity, like water contamination, that innovation is happening more in the universities here. In private enterprise, you're really seeing what Mark said, completely cost-driven, economics-driven innovation. And I'll give you our example. Our price point in the oil field today is less than half of what we started with 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And to Marcus's point about designing for change, the change we design for is it ever reducing cost of water. Mm-hmm. When we started the company, we thought, look, we should be in water because it's an ever-increasing cost of water, which is true because water scarcity is growing, water use is growing, but technology is getting better, so that is actually lowering the net cost of water. So we plan for being half the cost of where we are today in 2 more years if the trend continues. But in the end, it's economics, it's price point. If you know something is 2 cents, if burning natural gas is 2 cents cheaper than going solar, private companies will do that. Unless they are mandated by a government, like has happened in China, in India, in some cases, where things have gone so far that you really need government intervention, and then yes. But when pure private decisions are made, they're all based on cost.
I mean, on the public side, I mean, to get directly to your question, I mean, there are large quantities of money flowing into resiliency. Mm-hmm. Particularly for public projects, it's a result of the cultural shift around our focus on the impacts of natural disasters, primarily, particularly in the U.S. But from a commercial opportunity perspective, those kind of drivers probably mostly exist on the public sector. Okay. So if you're doing flood control, if you're doing work around how to build better infrastructure for storm surge. I think those are actually pretty good places to be, and I think they will continue to be. I mean, one driver that I think there are almost no questions about is global sea level rise. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, the data is just, it doesn't matter if you can observe a simple graph, you can see what the direction of the graph is, and those consequences are pretty severe and dire, and they're pretty hard to argue about. And if you're targeting that specifically, that's a pretty good place to be. There are very few things that we're really sure about, and one of them is global sea level rise. So,
true. So I would like to continue on the point which Anurag mentioned. So you mentioned how there's a difference between what universities do and what is there in the private sector. So the question is, we at MIT are really proud of the innovation that we do here, but is there is there a fundamental difference between the problems that need to be solved and the problems that are being solved by researchers? And how is the current collaboration between industry and academia in this regard?
Yeah, so I mean, in our view, what the universities and academia is doing is extremely important. I mean, everything we do has its origins in academia, either at MIT or other universities. Mm-hmm. The difference is academia can take a longer term view. And therefore, so, what the innovation in private companies versus innovation in academia, I don't think you can say, one is more important than the other or better than the other. They're different stages. They are different risk profiles. And we think that some things, the holy place for them is in academia. And other things get to a point where, okay, now a private company is ready to take it and run with it. And there might still be a lot of innovation and commercialization and packaging and cost reduction and optimization that needs to be done. But the difference is, I think, academia does more fundamental, even when it's applied, right? So you have a spectrum of, you know, what the science departments might do versus the engineering departments. Engineering is much more applied. And that, you know, if you keep moving along that trend, you get from math to science to engineering to private enterprise and gets more and more applied. And when it's ready and meets the cost limitations and so on, that's when it gets adopted by. So I think, and I think especially places like MIT are working on very real problems. Of course, there's always some part of research that will never be commercialized or never be used by, you know, anyone, at least for the next 100 years. But you learn things from that that are applicable in other ways. You know, we have professors and students, postdocs working here on just, you know, not in, you know, in the engineering departments, but definitely in the science department, on just looking for the truth or the, you know, knowledge. And that's the motivation. And while that may not directly be adopted by anyone, but the learnings that come out of that are adopted by folks, I mean, in our world, who are making membranes, who are developing new thermal processes, who are making more efficient systems, heat exchangers, so on.
Can I jump in there too?
Yeah,
sure. So I just want to make a plug for a really cool MIT program called the MIT Climate Collab. Raise your hand if you've heard of the MIT Climate Collab. Yes, that's awesome. So I've been a fellow for them for 3 years, and I encourage all of you to get involved. It's really cool. But they're really looking at crowdsourcing to get to the solutions for climate change. And I was lucky enough to be able to run this last season, the Energy Water Nexus contest for them. And I think it's applicable because it's really bringing in ideas from everyone. You don't have to be at an institution, you don't have to be in a company, you don't have to be in the government. Everyone's coming together and working on the, you know, someone puts a proposal in and then everyone can comment on it to try to make it better. And I love that model as far as innovating together.
Yeah, I would say on the academic side, and I mean, it's the collaboration for our company is very important with academics. Some of the really big opportunities, as was discussed yesterday, are integrative opportunities. You know, there are these complex problems that require multidisciplinary approaches. Some of them aren't, from an integrative perspective, aren't particularly interesting academically. Mm-hmm. They may be very practical, but they're challenging to kind of bring these pieces together. And I think that a lot of institutions, MIT is probably better at this than most, but you know, incorporating the practical side of building real things and integrating kind of disparate disciplines. I mean, the one for us is the number of hydroinformatics experts, people that both have like a civil engineering background and are world class in information technology, mm-hmm. are really limited. You know, I mean, these are kind of two fields that attract very different types of people, particularly in academic settings, and but that integration is so fundamental to getting water right, mm-hmm. from our perspective. So, for folks that are thinking about where to head, taking kind of if you pick two disparate things that are really interesting together, it's a fantastic place to be right now because that's maybe where the most opportunity is. Maybe it always has been, but particularly around water, that's where it is.
I want to echo what Marcus was just talking about that. At IDE, we don't so much get involved in doing sponsored research and that type of thing. One of the challenges there is the question of intellectual property and confidentiality, mm-hmm. that rushing to publish something is not high on our list when we want to, you know. But where we are looking to do more relates to when you get a little farther along where you've got something, it's time to take it to the field, if you will, to be able to apply that. We recently did a project in Alberta in the oil sands there with the technology. It's different than shale plays, and we have a technology to do. Well, we can say we have it all day long, but until you take it to that market, demonstrate it, show it, gather the numbers, And we worked with an entity called Innovate, Alberta Innovates, I think is what it's called, connected to the provincial government there and the universities, where they were our third-party validator. And so it's important to be able to have those, and it is a bit more on the applied side, but you know, if there's innovations coming out of MIT that need to go to work in regions other than Massachusetts, you know, what we want to be able to do is to be able to find the best, take them to those markets and be able to demonstrate them. Certainly, the oil and gas sector's that way. They're in a show me, don't tell me mode. And so we have to be able to do that. So keep that in mind, that is, if you've got something that's got legs and you need places to demonstrate it, that's where we like it and can work with you. And there's geographies where you can go to do that.
So maybe I want to like slightly shift gear at this point. And so we were talking about innovation. So provided we have this innovation, so how accessible are the current technologies that build climate resilience to the developing world? And at the same time, how important is it for the countries to encourage indigenous innovation when compared to just having technology transfer from the developed countries?
Well, you know, here again, the availability of technology is, it comes down to the customer and who's going to pay for it. You know, the challenge we face, we heard, you know, one of the speakers yesterday, where you've got countries where people talk about water as a human right. It may be, but somebody's got to pay for it. And so that's the biggest hurdle we found, is in some of these places where, quote, there is a lot of demand, there's not enough effective demand to do that. And so, and there are smart people around the world coming up with new technologies and practices to fit those situations. And so, and that's why one size doesn't fit all. One of the issues we're dealing with in the Texas market, for instance, is in most places where seawater desal plants are built, you've got access, direct access to the open ocean for dilution of brine and, you know, more consistent water coming in. Well, on the U.S. Gulf Coast, lots of rivers, bays, estuaries, fluctuation in water quality, it's different in other parts of the world of that. So you have to go into those places and be able to work with entities, universities, and others to adapt technology to those local conditions.
I wanted to mention something about, information sharing, best practices sharing, something we're looking at doing. We recognize that a lot of what we end up doing is here in the US, we're looking internal to ourselves, but there are a lot of people in other countries that have been dealing with similar issues for a while, like look at Australia, look at Israel, et cetera. So one of the things I'm helping DOE do is try to stand up a multilateral platform for the Energy Water Nexus. I think this would be the first large scale one. This would be under the International Energy Agency, something called an implementing agreement, where any country in the world could sign on to this. And actually, it's open to other partners, academia, industry, other multilaterals, AKA Irina could join if they wanted, to start sharing that information, sharing the data, improving our models. A lot of this data crosses borders. I mean, groundwater crosses borders, is transboundary stuff. That's one of the things we're looking at.
We're pretty optimistic about, obviously we're focused on this information integration into making decisions and controlling infrastructure, but that many of the technologies that are becoming available in developed countries will allow developing countries to kind of skip over this period of inefficient solutions. So you see this obviously in communications infrastructure is what everybody cites, right? I mean, you go straight from having, you know, no power to having a cell phone and skipping over the rural electrification era in the United States and, you know, telecommunications construction. So we've seen that in other areas. I think that it's not a complete analogy, but certainly there are lots of opportunities to identify technologies that allow for really skipping over these inefficiencies. And I guess that leads me to be optimistic that there are solutions that that can help in really significant ways. But it does get down to economics. And I think it's really hard to see how all this is going to play out, especially new technologies. I mean, like I said in my talk, I mean, some of these approaches are only a couple of years old. But gosh, I mean, the changes, there are probably at least 1,000 internet-connected sensors in this room right now, right? I mean, every one of you has an accelerometer attached to you, right? Even in 2007, like, that would have been kind of a ridiculous idea. And that wasn't that long ago. So things are changing really quickly, and it's hard to see how that's all going to play out. But I have no doubt that it's going to be really fundamentally transformative and probably will affect the developing world in ways that are hard to predict. So.
Yeah, just that, you know, to your question, Divya, technologies, how accessible they are now, they are. You know, you could be in India or China by tomorrow morning. Yeah. And that information transfer, ability to travel, cross-border investments being eased up has made these things a lot quicker to translate. Mm-hmm. But also, we must remember that a lot of the problems of the developing world don't need new technology.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're infrastructural problems. A lot of times, they're policy problems. And while technology, you're absolutely right, it will help the developing world skip over stages, but there are a lot of things that can be solved, you know, maybe more than half of the problems by existing technology. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, we always hear about water in Africa, right? It's not like there's no water in the Congo, mm-hmm. but it's inaccessible.
Yeah.
And along that point, I actually heard this from a student, and I think it was an MIT student, and it kind of shaped my thinking. But thinking about the nexus, when I think about the developed world versus the developing world, a lot of times the developing world, the problem in the nexus is the energy you need for the water stuff, all this water stuff for sanitation, blah, blah, blah. In the developing world, it's kind of the opposite. It's the water you need for the energy, because we're much more developed on our energy.
So. Let me, one other thing on a positive, but it's probably politically incorrect. One of the better things we got going for us is generational shift. Mm-hmm. Because in municipal entities in particular, there's a hesitancy to try something new. The water sector is the worst. Everybody wants to be second. They'd rather be third. And so, but with your generation becoming city managers and mayors and councilmen and, you know, getting involved in that process, that's going to help. So funerals and retirements are the best thing we got going for. you know, it is what it is.
Even just comparing the electric utilities to the water utilities, there are stark differences about metering. A lot of times your water metering, you get one number every few months, whereas in electricity, that's changing a lot. A lot of the water metering is not digital yet. Just stark differences.
Yeah, I along those lines, I mean, on the information side, I mean, the way we view it is the future is probably about radical transparency.
Yeah.
That the idea that, you know, if there's some strategy or system that's predicated on the inability to observe or the inability to act, that, you know, those strategies are probably limited in their lifespan.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, we spend a lot of time, for example, on the scientific side modeling, and we're shifting to, I think, a world in which we can observe. You know, even and it feels very different, and the choices are very different. And I think even those, you know, we say around developing countries, maybe these issues are largely political. The technologies exist, but on the information side, I think that the technologies themselves, radical transparency about information, can change those political systems. I mean, this example yesterday about the Nile and agricultural use, and I mean, this is like a grand optimization data collection problem. We need to obviously have those data collection platforms and fundamental technologies around sensing to drop dramatically in cost, but that's happening at an exponential rate.
Very fast.
And when we have those kinds of tools, I think we really will transform the way that we, you know, even act and develop regulations. I mean, mostly regulations are the ones, the Clean Water Act, for example. Most of the Clean Water Act, the regulations were built around the fact that we couldn't observe these things. Mm-hmm. Even the basic structures about how frequently you need to be in compliance are, you know, we'll pick a daily time scale, or we did 20 years ago because it was intractable to do minute by minute, and it's It's like ridiculously inexpensive to do minute-by-minute observation these days. So that's just going to continue to happen.
And you wouldn't imagine how many times the word drones comes up in my work now, not for aerospace, but for water. And
So maybe, Marcus, you can tell us, like, what are the greatest challenge in stormwater drainage design for densely populated flood-prone areas in the developing world with very poor infrastructure? Like, it's maybe specific to what you do.
Right. Sure. You know, in we don't work as in the developing world as much as we do in the developed world, but I think the challenge. Is primarily about the fact that these areas are primarily built. You know, new technologies, particularly in water, are easy to implement when you have kind of greenfield conditions. Mm-hmm. Like, it's easy to reinvent cities in China right now because you're building the city from scratch, right? Mm-hmm. So I think the biggest challenge is taking what we have. And doing as much as we can with it, dealing with the systems we have. I think if you're thinking about a company, for example, I'll throw in some advice about what types of water companies make sense. But not doing kind of a radical transformation of some process or system. And I think that's true of cities also. Mm-hmm. You've got to work with what's there, and in developing countries, that's particularly true. Mm-hmm. So. That's where not always is it the case that things exist, but you've got to work within those existing systems. So we're far from taking existing systems in water in developing countries and having them function in some optimal way. So I think I'd head in that direction, and that's what we're trying to do. So
So again, I'm gonna shift the gear again. So maybe this is more moving towards the energy water nexus. And so we know that climate change affects the balance between the use of energy for water and use of water for energy. And how can we take advantage of this interrelationship between water and energy to solve the problems in either?
Yeah. So I would say the first thing is you kind of want to reduce how much water you need for energy, mm-hmm. and vice versa, right? So just looking at conservation, looking at efficiencies, I mentioned metering already, behavioral stuff is gonna make a big difference. The loss of water from pipes, just our infrastructure is so bad right now, that if we could save that much water, that would help a lot. And then you start thinking about the nexus basically means that all of the water you're transporting, you had to clean at some point, so that took energy. So you're losing this water, but you're not just losing the water, you're losing the energy as well. It's kind of like a cascading effect. Actually, I wrote a blog post about this for World Water Day last year, actually calculating what's the infinite sum of how much energy and water for energy. Anyway, so then you go a step further, and you start talking about the synergies, which I think is what you were getting at. Mm-hmm. What are the cool energy water nexus synergies that we can use to help solve these problems? So a few that I think of right off the bat, one is water treatment. So the wastewater that we see in our wastewater treatment plants, mm-hmm. interestingly, that water actually contains about 5 times as much energy as is needed to clean it up. That's in thermal energy, that's in chemical energy, a little bit in the motion of the water itself. So we can actually use some cool new technologies like anaerobic digestion, et cetera, to start creating gases that we can use again. So just harvesting that energy from the water, from our wastewater. Something else to think about is pumped storage hydropower. It's a very obvious connection there. You can store energy by pumping water uphill and then letting it run back down again when you need the energy. Another one that kind of sparked my imagination early on was putting solar panels over canals of water. So when you're transporting water, you don't want evaporation, so you want to cover it, but hey, you could put solar panels on top. Sometimes a problem with solar panels is you don't have the room to put them in, so that's an obvious one. Another interesting one that's come up a lot in our talks with water and electric utilities sitting together is thinking about flexible scheduling of electricity as a form of demand response. So basically, desalinating when you have more energy, or treating your water when you have cheaper energy. It kind of helps balance out the intermittent energy problem with some renewable energies. Another one is there's actually a thought that you can take the carbon dioxide. I'm sure you all have heard of CCS, carbon capture and storage. But sometimes, or people are thinking about taking that carbon dioxide and injecting it in wells where, because of the pressure change, you're actually going to get water back up. And yeah, it's going to be salty or even maybe nuclear in sometimes. But being able to clean that up, so another source of water.
I know somebody who can do that.
Oh, okay, we'll talk. Yeah. And then the last one I wanted to mention is taking waste heat from plants. A lot of, I don't know if you noticed that on my Sankey diagram, but about 40% of power plants, you just get waste heat. So what if you take that waste heat and use it for something like desalination, where you only need low-grade heat for certain kinds of thermal desal? And then, so that's the synergies, but then I want to close by saying that you really need to start thinking about this as a systems problem, right? A lot of people here think about water, a lot of people think about energy, a lot of people think about ag, but if you start thinking about all of them together, that's really what we need. And I know someone who mentioned the optimization, so the optimization of systems, very important. And I'll throw another idea out there, taking produced water from fossil and cleaning it up enough so that you can use it to cool power plants, so that you can use it for agriculture, et cetera.
One of the other things, you mentioned that, like on the thermal side, our plants in India and China are thermal plants. We take the waste heat from the refineries to be able to do that. So, you know, there is certainly a way to do it. To your point on optimization and working with industries, a trend that we see there, petrochemical refineries and others, they don't want to be in the water business, but they don't always have these optimized systems. It's like so many of them will have cooling towers, but they rarely treat that cooling tower blowdown to be able to reuse it again. Mm-hmm. And so I think the trend's gonna be is that companies like are here can say, look, we're gonna handle your water issues, supply, reuse, you know, to get it from that best source, because those companies are in the refining business or making plastic or food or whatever it will be. So I think they're beginning to look at it differently now going forward.
So since this was mentioned when Noel was talking, so no climate talk can escape the mention of green technology or clean technology. So I was wondering, desalination other water treatment technologies are in general very energy intensive. So I was wondering if there's a general movement towards not using fossil fuels, so we can have.
I'm going to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. Whatever makes the cheapest water. Is what they're going to do. Now, that said, our plant in Carlsbad, California, that is now selling water out of that, we did complete renewable energy offsets. And it's paper electrons, if you will, that we offset the energy consumption with wind power. We can do the same in Texas. Australia, several of their plants, I know in Perth, they did that. It is possible. It is possible in West Texas, in these areas, where we have brackish water, we have oil and gas production, we have wind. Challenge is the wind in West Texas, in most of the West, blows great at 3 o'clock in the morning. So make water, store that water at night, and then it can be accessible, blend it with produced water that's come in to do it that way. Our plants now in Israel, we cycle them like that. Hadera, for instance, is right next to a power plant. We run at only about 20 or 30% of capacity during the day and run it all out at night. All of our plants, we're going to be looking to do that. Co-locating, whether it's desal or waste treatment, with a power production facility makes a lot of sense. We call it behind the meter, behind the fence. Power costs, you're buying wholesale versus retail. And one project that can't go into a lot of detail now, but that we're working on, is to design a clean burning natural gas plant with a desal plant, design them, build them, and operate them in an optimized fashion. will save you a lot. And so, because to date now, we just built a desal plant next to an existing power plant. Mm-hmm. Yes, you get some efficiencies, but if you build them together and cycle them mm-hmm. right, you save even more.
And something to think about there is, you know, when I first started this job, I didn't realize that renewable energies, trying to pair them with a desal plant, had more technical problems than just thinking about the renewable and just thinking about the desal. Trying to pair them up together actually gives you more issues that you have to worry about. And I think that there are some leading work that's happening in the spaces in the Middle East. And the reason, and I found this interesting, the reason is because in the Middle East, a lot of times they want to take their fossil energy and sell it. They get a higher price for selling it than they would for using it themselves. So they're the ones that are actually moving towards the renewable energy-based water production. Mm-hmm. And so we can learn from them.
Yeah. Well, and one of the things that, but it can be done, mm-hmm. and it's why you probably can't have a desal plant that's run on actual real electrons, 100% renewable, mm-hmm. because in reverse osmosis, you can't totally, you can, but it doesn't mm-hmm. work very well to shut it down. You always have to have pressure on those membranes. So if you can, the bulk of the time, if you can use renewable, great, but you always got to have a backup there, you know, natural gas fired or whatever it may be. But, you know, that's doable. I'll tell you, though, the challenge I think I mentioned to you, Noel, you know, we have talked to groups in West Texas about building brackish desal plants actually on a wind farm mm-hmm. to be able to do this. But the impetus for building so much wind is about the production tax credit. Mm-hmm. So build the thing, get the tax credit, and put the electricity on the grid. If that begins to change, it makes a lot of sense to be able to co-locate those, to be able to buy that, cycle it when you can. Mm-hmm. Because wind in much of the West at night, when the wind's blowing so well, is that power is virtually free. Mm-hmm. But you gotta have a wind farm owner developer who's motivated by something other than a tax subsidy.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So in the interest of time, so we can open questions from the audience. And I request that whoever is asking a question, please mention their name and affiliation before you ask the question. And the mic is right there.
Pallavi Mande with the Charles River Watershed Association. First a comment and then a question. I think one of the things that I feel is sort of an issue that a lot of you guys alluded to, but maybe we didn't have a discussion on that, and I'm wondering if you have any thoughts, is that there is definitely the process of finding markets and having technology to address those markets. I think we do a great job here at MIT and other schools like that. Maybe when we are thinking about systems thinking, I like your comment, Anurag, about getting to your clients, understanding the problem, coming back to your lab, figuring out how technology can address that, and going back and testing that out. And I wonder if that kind of thinking, and I don't know which sector can do it well, between the private, the public, or a combination of the two, or maybe a nonprofit, who knows, can actually figure out whether there's a role for public education and creating not markets as much as sectors for meeting needs that might not be aware, first of all, of the technology options that are out there. And secondly, might not have the resources to either afford them right off or be able to test them if they're not been established for a while. So question sort of specifically to you, Marcus. Clearly, I think from the perspective of where Opti might have its most use, you know, we're looking at municipalities who are either driven by regulatory frameworks that we've created or lawsuits potentially that they might be facing. for the Clean Water Act. Why isn't this technology serving them right away? Is it just because it's new and people feel like there's a lot of risk, maybe? Or is it a mindset, an engineering mindset? Or is it about maybe not trusting the technology or being able to control it the way we've controlled things in our infrastructure planning?
Yeah, I think it's a really interesting thing that we think about quite a bit, obviously, from a commercial perspective. Relative to maybe just water in general, I'm always, you know, I think most of us, if we're here today, we've taken our Saturdays to focus on water. It's not at the top of the list of, in people's minds yeah. about what's kind of important in the world, I think, on a daily basis. I'm always kind of stunned at how few people know about what our challenges are around water, just in general. And it varies greatly kind of where you are in the world and where in the US, where you are in the country, about if you just pick 20 people on the street and ask them about some basic issue, how aware they are. And that plays out on the political side, and it plays out relative to urgency to solve the problems. So in places where there are kind of really strong regulatory drivers, we, you know, as a company with the types of things we're doing, which are very innovative, there are good, you know, they're good drivers. The Chesapeake Bay is a great example. Los Angeles is a great example right now. I mean, you know, it's like takes a drought for people to get excited about this stuff, but they are. So I think there's actually a lot that we can do about kind of lowering the barrier for people to access information about these types of issues. And I think we, even as a company, but certainly as a community, have a really important role to play in doing that. We did a study a while back on, I think most of you, if you live in Boston, you can get your water meter data online. So has anyone in this room who lives in Boston, okay, have you ever looked at your water meter online? You know, like you're not gonna do it. Even if you really care, there's too much like energy to get that information because the decision is just not that important to you, right? But we can do interesting things around directly connecting people in ways that don't require them to kind of take on additional cognitive burden. And this idea of radical transparency from my perspective is one of them, is how do you, it's data science, how do you roll up information in ways that it's meaningful to people so that they can absorb it and compete with all the other pieces of information. So this is even true from a commercial acceptance perspective of new technologies. I mean, it's true for all of us, right? We're trying to, in one way or another, change the way people are doing things, even in government positions. It's that kind of fun challenge about how do you do that in ways that fit into what motivates people to act. And you know, I hear a lot like, hey, we need more disasters. This is when people pay attention. We need a drought. But I think we can do better than that. Markets are a great way to drive things. It's the most powerful, I think, force for innovation anyone's ever created is like true markets and pricing. But then also just plain creativity, but really thoughtful creativity. So I don't know, did that answer, Polly?
I have an anecdote about the drought part. I had a layover in Texas. This was like 3 months ago, and I was at a Starbucks there. And I saw that they had left a little sink running, and I freaked out. went over and turned it off. And the woman walks over and she's like, "Are you from California?" I'm like, "No, but they do have a drought." And hey, Texas, you might want to be worrying about that too. I think something to think about is what we call the boom-bust cycle, and you kind of mentioned it. So we have a drought now, and people are kind of throwing their focus onto water, which is great, it needs a focus, but with El Nino and everything else coming on, all of a sudden we're gonna be in the bust where, you know, maybe desal plants like Santa Barbara get shuttered again. So just something to think about, and I very much love your answer about you need to think outside of this you know, what are people worried about? Start looking at markets and creativity and other things.
The other sort of following on to that, I mean, part of public education is also to tell people that a lot of water supply in the world is subsidized.
Yeah.
And you know, there's a reason why most desalination plants in the world have some sort of government ownership.
Yep.
And so people think water's free when it's not. Someone's paying for it, your taxes are paying for it, or you know, the oil budget's paying for it. But it is a reason why people don't directly relate to the cost of water. And I think explaining that to the populations would help them appreciate how expensive and energy intensive water is.
And a step further is that they don't realize the embedded water in things. So we talk about water embedded in energy. People have no idea how much water is used for energy. Water embedded in everything, in the production of your clothes, all industries.
Food.
So much water. Food, thank you. If we can start educating on that, people will be just boggled.
I will paint a little bit of a different vision, though, around this. Like, people actually don't care about data. They actually don't want to know about the problems. What they care about is outcomes. Mm-hmm. I showed all these great dashboards, right? Hey, you can spend all day watching your water. And when it really comes down to it, it's not what we think the world should look like. We think people should focus on outcomes. They should expect that their city functions in the way that they want it to function without them actually having to get involved, right? So if you're really gonna come up with, I think, game-changing solutions around these things, it's not really about getting people to understand what you understand as an expert. It's about delivering the outcomes that they expect.
Yeah.
And then letting them know from a political perspective why they should expect those outcomes or how they got them. So I spoke at a data science conference, and maybe one of the more controversial things that we actually say frequently is data isn't for people. We're not very good at interpreting it. The quantities it comes in now are just astounding. We have to spend a lot of time just to making it so that we can even understand it in ways that are even actionable. It's probably ideally for other machines. And when we, like for example, I could sit down and look at one of the algorithms we're running. It will take me, because they're complex algorithms that are based on minute-by-minute changing conditions of forecasts and sensors and flows, and they're non-ideal. It will take me hours, literally, to figure out what our algorithms did at a detailed level to understand it for an individual storm event. And they're happening every minute. Like, there's no way I could even remotely control it with this information, let alone understand what it did exactly, but I know the outcome was right. I know if that storm I said, you know, no discharge, the tank's full at the end, it's available for use. That's the outcome I wanted. I don't really care, certainly as the public, I don't care how that happened. I want my city to function. So if there's a direction we could head, we can do that more, just to focus on the outcomes and not try to get people to even understand how we got them or why we care.
Not everybody's a water nerd. All of us. One other thing, too, that we have an entity that we've started in the state of Texas, a municipal water consortium lab, to where you look at somebody's house or an office building or whatever. They started out tracking electric consumption, and now we're going to be able to do it in water consumption for a building. Not that we're going to sit there and look at it, but you have to think about when you go buy your first home, or you design, your architects that graduate from here design a building, is to make it a second thought that of course you're going to build in all these efficiencies. But we met with the Texas Association of Home Builders and brought this up. Why didn't people, you know, more water efficient? The guy was very, he says, look, nobody comes into a showroom in a development where they're building new homes and rants and raves about the water utilities, but they'll spend 2 hours arguing over what color of countertops they want in the kitchen.
Yeah.
And so, you know, that's where you've got to get the creative of how you embed it. The other challenge that we've got is there are multiple hundreds of cities in the United States where revenue from your water bill doesn't go back just to pay for the water and the upkeep. It goes to build the new baseball fields, pay for the Christmas parade. And that's another challenge you've got, that people, it's a business to a lot of these places. a lot of city managers do not like water conservation because they need that revenue, not just for the water utility, but because it's built into the city budget. So those are things that we've done to ourselves politically, but I go back, funerals and retirements are our best friends. So.
With the exception of some of the comments that Noel made, I've not been particularly uplifted by the conversation. I worry that the funerals and the retirements aren't going to be meaningful unless we're talking about issues honestly today. You'd think that at the Institute that would be possible. And I understand why we have to be careful about not offending our constituents, whether it's Congress or whether it's the traditional energy sector. But for crying out loud, if we're trying to solve the water problem by burning more fossil fuel, then it's not a solution, is it? So how do we get past this? How do we introduce some honesty into the conversation and realize that we have to come up with solutions that don't exacerbate the cause of the problem?
I'm not so sure that burning fossil fuels is necessarily wrong. I mean, you see, we're all burning fossil fuel everywhere, right? You know, cars, planes, everywhere. I think you got to get better at it. You have to be more efficient at it. We're not going to, as much as we want or talk about it, we're not going to eliminate fossil fuels. I think a lot of us will agree with that. But what new technologies driven by market pressures, driven by cost and economics are doing is using less energy. And now, you know, there are cases, you know, you're right, there are places where people will burn gas as opposed to using renewables because it's cheaper. Yep. But they'll go with what burns less gas rather than more gas. And we've seen that firsthand in Texas, where obviously it's a fossil fuel country, where people have selected us over other technologies that would have used more fossil fuel. So, I mean, I think the conversation should be around getting more efficient, but we have to be practical that we can't eliminate the use of. And from our standpoint, you know, as a growing private enterprise, you've got to be in the system to change it rather than trying to attack. I mean, did I understand your question right?
I mean, my optimism, I'll go back to information, but radical transparency is a way to get there. Yep. I mean, I think the reason that, I mean, we have no idea, I have no idea where the power is coming from for this room, right? But maybe I should know. You know, maybe it would be important to me and information, maybe I'm an idealist around these things. I doubt that that's not the case. But information is really a very first step to understanding any of these problems. We can't even make rational decisions in our daily lives in ways that we're not even willing to do unless we have efficient ways of doing that that don't overburden us. That's one way to go, and I think we're just at the very beginning of that. If someone comes to your house and they know exactly what the consequences are of your decisions, there are social pressures we haven't even begun to tap to influence people's behavior. And it's worked really well. I mean, we've had some things in our lifetimes where we've kind of changed social norms in really significant ways. I mean, the one that I always hear is like seatbelt usage, right? Yeah. You know, I mean, maybe it's not trivial from a lives perspective, certainly, at a societal level, but you know, pretty fundamental change in people's behavior around social norms. And it basically has to do with the fact, hey, you can see if somebody's wearing a seatbelt or not. It's really transparent. It takes almost no effort to change your behavior. and the consequences are really significant from a human perspective. So those types of things, maybe if we head in that direction, we can get somewhere.
Yep. Hi, thank you very much for the interesting conversation. As someone who's interested in spinning out graduate school research on water in the next 2 or 3 years, I'd love to hear your thoughts on what are the biggest technological challenges facing water startups or the water industry in general, and number two, what are the biggest entrepreneurial challenges to spinning something out like that?
Well, I'll take a crack at the technological challenges kind of from our perspective. One, as we just talked about, how to handle water, whether it's desal or treating wastewater, lower energy footprint, lower chemical use, just be able to get that cost down. And there's incremental progress being made, and I think we'll continue that. I mean, desalination has gotten much more efficient and lower cost over the last 20 years, and we'll move in that direction. One of the things that we have to deal with, Gradient has to deal with, you've got waste streams coming from this, being able to deal with those in a sustainable fashion, whether it's sewage sludge or it's a great topic just before lunch, salt from a desal project to be able to do that. So I think those are kind of, for us, pushing that efficiency all the time to be able to get there is certainly going to be a bigger issue for us. And as we were just talking about, but the other big thing is just consumer behavior and how we deal with that. When we look at it, there's some things out there that, quote, will be good for our business, but kind of scare me. We heard some of them yesterday. One that scares me a lot is that rural Chinese citizens use 40 liters a day of water. Urban Chinese use 200 liters a day. That trend's going to continue. We've got a long way to go, but I would say anywhere you can push that efficiency, the reuse component is going to be key. But one of the other challenges that get into it in the environmental sciences, it's like on reuse of treated wastewater. If you start reusing all that and you're putting less back into a river, what happens to the environmental flows in that river? So the consequences of the one, you may create another problem. How you balance that is going to be, and that's as much a technological issue as it is a policy issue.
Another thing to look out for, and I'm sure you all are very aware of this, but water regulations change by locality. We don't have a federal water anything. So, it depends where you are.
With companies, if you're thinking about, entrepreneurship and company formation, I think Gradient's a great example. The ideal thing is to build a platform, like a company around the way you apply solutions to a whole bunch of different problems, particularly in water. I think there's this myth of finding a unique technology that no one else has found that's going to change the world, right? And I think most companies don't look anything like that. It's very, very rare. And particularly coming out of academia, you have this intense focus, let's say, working in a PhD dissertation on a very specific thing. But real companies frequently, and they mostly look like platform businesses that solve kind of problems in a more diverse way. So I think looking for things that look like they could be the basis for a platform that could solve many problems, that can pivot easily to solve other problems. I mean, you guys have pivoted a couple of times, right? And you're still pivoting. Is a really good way to go. So maybe even if you're focused on something very specific, taking a step back and say, is this a subset of a group of solutions that all fit together really nicely? And then putting those together makes a lot of sense. I mean, we've done that. We are a control. A generic control solution from the cloud. We've chosen to focus on stormwater because it's a great market, but we also control landfill gas wellheads, but we haven't built a company around that because it's not a great market. But we could do that. We could pivot to that. So I'd encourage you to head that way.
Yeah, so following on that, I think, there's having that you know, the unique solution that solves every problem is a myth. But I think you do need something to get in, to get your foot in the door. It's like, you know, your MIT degree, it gets you in the door, but then, you know, you do what you do with it. So you need something that excites people, inspires people, and gets you in there. Right. But then, just like with any business, not just in the water industry, you have to be honest about what you're good at and what you're bad at. And you have to recognize when stuff's working and when it's not. You can't keep fooling yourself into believing that what you have is the best, it will solve all of world's problems. And even if you get there, you know, in 3 years, 5 years, a better solution would have come along. Mm-hmm. So learning, I mean, the most, again, you know, I speak obviously from hearing from others, but the most successful companies aren't those that found the new greatest idea, but those that learned and evolved along the way. Hands down, across the board. That's right. In terms of technological problems and unsolved issues and challenges that are facing the water industry, we feel, and others may disagree or feel slightly differently, but we feel there's a lot of opportunity in the industrial sector.
Yep.
Because the municipal water treatment sector has made tremendous progress in the last 50 odd years. You know, cost of desalination by reverse osmosis has come down 5x. So I think you can get in there, and if you can make anything like that that's that large scale 10% better, you have a great market. But maybe there's more low-hanging fruit in places where cost is still very high. Industries only started looking at it in the last 5 to 10 years.
Yep.
Contamination levels are so high that people really care about it. So that may be the technological, but the entrepreneurial issues are the same with every company.
Thank you very much.
I think, I'm sorry, I have to close the audience questions at this point because of time. I'd like to thank the audience for their interesting questions. I actually managed to cover all the questions that I couldn't cover, and I'm truly satisfied to let the panelists go at this point. So I'd like to thank all the panelists for their amazing and unique contributions to the discussion. We spanned across innovation, energy, development, green technology, public awareness, and entrepreneurship challenges. And I think everybody had something to take away from this panel discussion. And I think most of the panelists will be available during the lunchtime after the keynote. And I would like to invite Professor Lienhardt to present a small memento to each of the panelists.